The following podcast is a production of Cascadia.fm.
And from the world of haute couture, Jesse McCoy.
Good morning.
Hey, how are you?
I'm good.
I missed you on Tuesday.
I was happy to sleep in, but I missed you too.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. It just isn't a Tuesday or a Friday if you and I aren't groggily making our way to downtown Portland, Oregon to do this show. And then providing information and comedy hijinks for the people that like to listen.
For the people groggily heading to work.
Yes, they may be on buses, they may be in cars, they may be already arrived. They're just getting into their cubicles, preparing for their day of commerce.
Have fun, sheep. Just kidding, we love you.
We do have actual sheep listening to the show, though.
Oh,
so
good.
Be careful not to, we don't want to disenfranchise them.
Just in the chat box, all caps.
You just told a bunch of sheep you want to give them a hand job.
Oh, I'm really bad with my sheep translations.
You are. You got to be careful because the sheep, they don't have a sense of irony. So they will take things seriously.
They should really get one with the life they're living.
Yeah. It is, a sheep's life is kind of ironic. You know, you're born a lamb. Everybody, you know, they love you. You're the one of the symbols of Easter.
And Jesus Christ himself.
Springtime.
A bunch of Greek people just want to slaughter you and cook you.
This is true. A few lambs do make it to a slaughter or two.
I worked at a Greek-owned establishment, and one of the kids who worked in the kitchen, one of the Greek kids, every Easter, the couple Easters I worked there, he would be like, "Do you want to see pictures of me slitting lambs' throats?" And I'm like, "No, I don't want to see your slaughter of animals." He's like, "No, it's really awesome. It's what we do every Easter." And I'm like, "Good for you, family tradition, but I don't need to look at your bloody phone photos."
He was in jail now. Oh, he's
not really.
Greek jail?
Greek jail.
Greek jail, I think. Greek jail would
it's
be fun.
It's even more depressing, actually. You think our jail systems are broke.
Yeah, but in, you know, Greek jail, I mean, gay sex, is there, I mean, it's just all sex, really.
Well, they invented, don't remind Greek men that they invented gay sex.
How did they invent gay sex?
Well, the Greeks.
I think there were cavemen probably having gay sex.
Well, they made it popular. How about that? They perfected it. The Greeks perfected it. Everybody's sticking things where they can, but the Greeks really got it down to an art. Mostly little boy fucking publicly. They're all
just the philosophers.
Well,
just
yes.
The philosophers. Well, that and baklava.
Delicious.
You know, Turkey and Greece are in a like 1,000-year battle over who came up with baklava. Like, some people say it's a Greek food, some people say it's
Turkey
a Turkish.
Turkey needs something to be proud of.
This is true. They don't. What are the cigarettes?
Ooh, the
clove cigarettes. They have those. Turkey. What else do they have?
I feel like opium. I feel like Turkey's a drug place. It makes me think of illicit substances.
They do have the 1967 caper movie Top Cappy. If you've never seen that, take a look at that. That's
I love old caper films, so I'll get right on that.
There you go. Well, you've really rolled out of bed and into something spatial this morning. And by spatial, I mean the...
Are you calling me fat?
No. Why? Because I rolled you out of... Somebody rolled you out
spatial.
Of bed?
Spatial. It's just lady logic. Anytime space or size is brought up, you just say, "Are you calling me fat?"
Oh, I see. No, spatial spelled S-P-A-T-I-A-L. Spatial reasoning. The ability to deduce reality from non-realities. Spatial.
Who's to say that this is reality?
Who is to say? And it's me because I'm the host. I say this is reality. I declare it now. So let's perfect reality.
Okay.
Much like the Greeks have perfected gay sex, let us now perfect reality.
They were also the first ones to ask what existence was, right?
I think a caveman asked that. He grunted it to another caveman.
You're
that
giving
he was...
cave people way too much credit. Their brains were not as developed as ours.
Listen, as Geico's marketing goes, so does
and
my...
And now some liquor. Because, you know, Geico did such a great job with the cavemen. Someone else had to adopt them.
Andrew in the chat box says he knows a lot about gay sex. Yes, that's because you're gay, Andrew.
It's a fact of nature.
You probably still smell of it this morning as you're chatting in. Well, I hope you washed your hands, let me just say.
Oh, yeah.
Always remember to douche first, he says. Ass douche? I don't know if... I didn't know that was a... I didn't know... Okay, now
if
I know too
polite.
Much about gay sex. If you're polite. God.
Which, let's just put it this way, most gay men are not.
Can we just end the show now? Let's just not, we're 6 minutes in, and I've already we're talking about ass douching.
I did not wake up for 6 minutes, all right? We're doing this shit.
You know what? You can go back to sleep anytime you want. I mean.
On the inside, I'm always sleeping.
Doesn't that coffee help?
Sometimes.
What brand of coffee do you drink? Let me ask.
Stumptown.
So you do you grind it yourself, or do buy a pre? Oh my!
I grind in a French press.
Nice. Now, French press. That's the one where you have to like push it down. Yeah, okay, I know. I know all about it now.
Yeah, I feel like good coffee tastes better that way, and I don't want it sitting around getting scorched in a coffee pot. Plus, I don't like having a bunch of appliances. I don't have a coffee pot or a microwave. I have a toaster and a KitchenAid mixer. Those are my kitchen appliances.
So, well...
And a refrigerator and a stove, obviously.
Do you have a coffee grinder?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, yeah, that's... you're right. Which also comes in handy for spices. You can grind a spice or two in there.
For baking? Or what?
Well, yeah, like...
Or pasta, or what?
Or, like, if you don't, let's say your pepper grinder breaks down, you grind that shit up in a coffee grinder.
All right. Okay. No, you know what? I'm on board with that. I have a peppercorn grinder.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's hand stuff. So I do with that. It's coarse. I like it. I like my pepper coarse.
It's best that way.
Of course. Yes. Well, it is Unibash Radio, as I have pre-mentioned. The chat box is open for your perusal and additions to the show. Andrew already taking full advantage of that, so join in with him. Also, the phone line is open. If you'd like to call in and describe your genitals to us, we're more than happy to entertain calls of such a nature. That phone number is 503-IT'S-DOPE. That's 503-487-3673. That reminds me. I got a... If you're listening on the podcast or the live show, for that matter, I extended my Skype with a Groupon.
Uh-huh.
There was a Groupon out last week, so I got this. I extended my Skype because, you know, Skype, it's not something that's inexpensive. But there was
I thought it was free.
If you're calling other Skype people.
Oh, okay.
Only. But if you want to call regular phone numbers or have inbound calls with a phone number of its own, like the 503, it's dope. That's not just like you just don't pull that out of the air. You have to pay for that. But always looking for deals on Skype. So that when the Skype Groupon came across and I saw that you could add it to your existing account, I jumped right on that. The other thing it included was a little device that you plug into a wall socket, then plug into your router, then plug your computer into the little device, or not your computer, but your actual normal landline telephone. And you can use your landline telephone.
Oh, killer.
So it's like my house now has it's kind of like has a landline again.
Oh, weird.
My phone is my normal pink. I have this, you've never even been in my house, but I have this pink stove. And I bought, many years ago, a pink telephone to match my stove.
Classy.
And it was
and
made by the Greeks.
And now you can finally work it.
Yeah, that the phone has not been in operation for several years, so now I have like a landline. It's pretty cool. The only thing, you cannot dial 911 with it.
Nope. Oh, yeah, because Ray wouldn't know which 911 to direct you to.
Something like that, yeah. So
every dead cell phone, even if it's been turned off for years, like cell phones, you can still call 911.
Well, that's one of the cool things about old cell phones. You can, if you have old cell phones lying around, donate them to women's shelters, and they will get them working and make sure they're in operable fashion, or in an operable fashion, I should say, not inoperable. But they will then give them to the folks that use their utilize their services for an emergency.
Yeah.
In case they're in trouble, they can call 911 anywhere they're at. Unfortunately, a lot of low income spectrum folks just can't afford the cell phones.
I can't even imagine what it would be like to not have a cell phone. Those poor people. Never mind the regular beatings, like not having a cell phone.
But can you imagine what it's like to be beat?
Yeah, I can. Actually, I can. So thanks for bringing up my childhood.
Well, we all went to high school, so we've all been there, maybe.
No, I beat people up in high school.
You were the bully?
Yeah, kind of. Not really so much in high school, but I was a scrapper in junior high. I used to beat up boys all the time. That was my thing. I was like, I'm not going to take your shit. I can beat you up.
And then they all got bigger than you.
Some of them. It's not that hard to be bigger than me. There was one kid in particular who did not get bigger than me, and that upset him. And I think he might have been one of the last people I fought. I haven't been in a fight in a really long time. And one bitch is trying to pick one with me now, and I might just let her. Just so I can remember what it feels like to punch someone. It's been a while.
Please, please let me be present for that. I would love to see you throw down.
I don't do like cutesy girl fights. Well, I didn't. I haven't.
I don't imagine you would.
I like to go for emotional scarring as well as bloodying.
All right. Well,
ruthless. Ruthless Buzzy is what they call me on the circuit.
Oh, God. Speaking of emotional scarring.
Plenty of it.
I'm going to jump right into the news here. What we do here is we kill the news. We take the stories and we put them through a potato masher, form them into a mountain of molten newsiness. Then we fill them with the gravy of comedy and pass it along to you on a platter.
I haven't had mashed potatoes and gravy in a while.
It's good eating.
I love mashed potatoes.
And you're from Idaho, so.
Yep. I like potato. I'm Irish and I'm from Idaho.
Wow.
I know my way around a potato.
Double whammy, they call it.
Yep.
That's the double whammy.
That was also like the only way I could get my really boring old boss to laugh is when I would say that. Well, you know, I'm from Idaho and I'm Irish. And he'd be like, those potatoes are delicious. And that was like all he laughed at. So I held on to that line. Worked every time.
There you go. It'll work with me as well. So
all right.
Roll it out anytime you like. Rockstar, that's debatable at this point, but Rockstar and New Jersey native John Bon Jovi has opened a pay what you can community kitchen in Red Bank, New Jersey this week. There are no prices on the menu. The idea is simple. If you can
There's no actual food on it either.
It's all just
like canned cheese and like weird God knows what.
It's like leaves from the trees. The idea is simple. If you can pay, great. Leave a donation. If you can't, volunteer in the kitchen or somewhere else in the community and get a gift certificate to the restaurant. Bon Jovi and his wife ran two pilot programs in Red Bank to assess the community's needs and its response. 2 years later, they renovated this former auto body shop and built the John Bon Jovi Soul Kitchen.
Soul Kitchen.
Bon Jovi didn't just front the money and let someone else run the place. He actually runs it and works in the kitchen himself.
Ooh, does he wear a hairnet?
His hair is short now. I don't know if you've seen him lately. His hair is very short. His dad's somebody told me his dad's a barber.
That would make sense. He's a good old American boy. Son of a barber. Grew up in New Jersey.
Cash Trap Dictator says, fuck Bon Jovi.
I don't care to, but okay. All right. Now, I enjoy this concept, but the idea of Bon Jovi making me some donation-based meal, I question it. Then again, not starving, so.
This is true.
I have a boyfriend who buys groceries for me.
There you go. There you go. That's all you need. Safeway delivers, by the way. Anyway, the menu is healthy and nutritious. Some ingredients are grown in a garden. Well, I would hope so. Not
I
in a.
Hope they're vegetables. They were grown somewhere.
Not in an interstate or something. I don't know what they're. Others are donated by Whole Foods. It's not capitalized, so I don't know if it's they mean the market.
Or it's a typo.
I don't think there's a Whole Foods in New Jersey.
Why wouldn't there be? They're everywhere.
Well, it is the Garden State.
Yeah.
You'll find everything from Garden State gumbo to pork chops and homemade carrot cake.
I like carrot cake. Not a fan of a pork chop. Not a big pig person.
No. If Bon Jovi has his way, there will be soul kitchens all over the country, even the world.
Oh, man.
He'll sleep when he's dead.
Kitchen.
He'll sleep when he's dead. I think that's what we're seeing here. If you would like more information about the Soul Foundation, or if you would like to make a donation, please visit John Bon Jovi, soulfoundation.org.
What is the whitest rocker in America doing calling his shit Soul Kitchen? Like, I don't like where he went with the naming.
Yeah, I should have. I mean, Soul was never.
He has no soul.
Yeah, he never. I mean, Rich was. What's the other guy? Richie Sambora. Richie Sambora. Sambora. That's what. Yeah. He was married to Heather Locklear for a long time. Yeah. I think they shared her. I think like they were
a little swapping.
Kind of a Chinese finger thing, you know.
When you're on that many prescription Chasing pills, Amy. You don't really know who you're. It doesn't matter as long as they're a musician and your rent is paid.
This is true. This is true. And
finger cuffs is what you're referring
to. Finger cuffs, that's it. The Chinese finger cuffs, yes.
I'm locked in there like a pair of Chinese finger cuffs.
Thank you. If Chasing Amy gave us nothing else other than Kevin Smith, it's that.
That was my favorite Kevin Smith movie in the beginning, and then I realized that was just because it was the first one I saw. So I was like, I love Chasing Amy. And then I was like, you were just like a PC, angry girl in high school. Like, there's better ones.
I'll tell you what, though. Joey Heather Lawrence.
If only she had a better voice.
I'm willing to overlook it.
I love her.
I'm willing to overlook it.
What was she? Oh, yeah. Did Weeds. You watch United States of Tara?
Oh, that's right. Not Weeds. It was United States of Tara. That's
both
right.
The husband and Tara were fucking her.
Yeah, that's...
Spoiler alert, two seasons ago.
Yeah, interesting triangle. Interesting triangle, yes.
Wasn't Kevin Smith married to her for a while, or they were in a long-term relationship, right?
I don't know.
I believe that was his lady for a long time.
I don't know.
I think that's how she got in so many of his movies.
That's very possible. It's very possible. I don't remember her acting skills being exceptional. I mean, workable.
She was a believable lipstick lesbian.
Yes. Yes. And she was, you know what, on United States of Terror, she was...
She made a good bar hag.
She was a good bar hag, indeed. Of course, United States of Terror, also the show that gave Matt Bronger a foothold in his television career.
He was
career.
Funny in that show. Yeah. I liked him. I'm not a huge fan. Like, I'm not a huge Matt Bronger fan. I understand Portland's love of him. Because he lived here for 2 minutes, and but whatever. That show made me like him a lot more. Made me give him another look because I enjoyed him.
He popped up on NBC Primetime the other night in that show with Christina Applegate and Will. What's
up
his name?
Up All Night.
Up All Night. Yeah, he was.
I still haven't watched it, but I've heard it's actually pretty good.
It's all right. It's all right. But I was surprised to see Mr. Bronger pop up on there. So.
He's a Hollywood darling.
He is. He's the darling of Hollywood.
I think people are finally forgetting about those sad Mad TV days, so he's allowed to work again. Yeah. Remember how shitty that show was? We were talking about that the other day because he had his taping. He taped his live album this weekend, and we all had a show. A few of us had a show beforehand and before going over there because, you know, we know people. We get comps to big shows. No big deal. But we were all talking about it. And I was just like, remember Mad TV and how awful it was, but your dad would, like, make you watch it with him, and it would be gross. That was all of our memories of Mad TV.
My memory of Mad TV is, you know, it aired, it was on, 11 and 12, right, on Saturday night.
So you watched it before Saturday
night. Exactly,
and
you would try to bounce back during the commercials of Saturday night before, this is pre-DVR, obviously. But
God, those days were awful.
They were horrific.
So hard.
Horrific. I don't know how we did it. How did we ever live, people, without the technology we have today? Just
well,
5 years
tried
ago,
to
even.
Do another new sketch show with that black guy whose name I can't remember. It's
still
in
on.
The vein, but it's not taping anymore.
Oh, it's not.
No,
okay.
It's done. But
well,
it
they
is
did
still
Spike.
The air.
Remember Spike Ferris and. There was in between there was like a talk show type thing with a white guy, Spike Ferriston, and they tried to get that going, but it didn't really work.
Oh, that show really just work. I was like, this is Mad TV all over again. Yeah. It's terrible.
All right, we'll be right back.
Okay.
In the meantime, touch yourselves.
Psychopath dressed as a clown. in my psyche, pulling me down.
Try to record it here.
It's Cascadia.fm.
We've got orbs and Dracula. Watch out for the fucking orbs.
The essence of Portland, the people, the food, the architecture, the style, and the enthusiasm of where we live. It all gets captured somehow, some way. Portland area photographer Stephen Lenhart specializes in lifestyle, studio, editorial, and commercial photography. He has the expertise and the passion to capture the essence you are looking for. Each client gets a private web gallery to view the results, including properly formatted digital images for just about every medium you could ever want. Stephen's studio is located in Southeast near the East Bank Esplanade. He also works with a stylist to ensure makeup, hair, and wardrobe are just the way you want them. Take a look at his photography portfolio at sdlenhart.com. That's sdlenhart.com. Price estimates, PDF portfolios, and client references are available upon request, or give Stephen a call at 503-564-4887. Photographer Stephen Lenhart, capturing the essence of Portland.
Easy to get into Vegas. Sometimes getting out is the problem.
I was just about to say, getting out is where it gets tricky.
And, although the Blue Man Group doesn't seem to have a problem. They're allowed to leave Vegas whenever they want.
There's just like 7 of them floating around. They're still in Vegas.
I think there's like more than 7. I think there's...
Well, I meant 7 troops.
Oh, so that's like,
they're
so that's
everywhere.
21 of them.
They're
that would be 21,
like,
right? Because there's 3 of them on stage, right?
I don't know. Is it 3 people on stage at a time? Yes.
I think they need to have some little people in there.
I think that would cheapen it.
I think it would add. It would add at least a half, 3.5 people.
I don't agree with adding midgets to things.
Why not?
Because, well, I not like how, I'm against little people. But, I mean, you don't just add a small person just for the fuck of it.
Robert did. He's adding a small person to his family.
Well, that's a little different. He made that himself.
He did. But Halloween is made more fun by small people. If it weren't for children and smaller people, that Halloween would not be half as fun.
Well, I think they just get in the way of drinking.
Don't let small people get in the way of drinking.
Ever.
All right. So, this story is, I don't know what it is about the Halloween time of year. The Bon Jovi story was kind of nice and flowery, but the rest of the stories today, just very, very, horrific.
Shit gets bleak in the fall.
This is from Suffolk County actually the town is Holbrook, New York. Suffolk County police arrested a Shirley woman. She's from Shirley, New York.
Shirley, she's kidding.
Shirley, you're just. For preparing to shoot up with heroin with her baby in the back seat of her car.
Now, was the car moving?
No. I'm glad you asked.
Things are fine.
I'm glad you asked. And you know what?
Do they live in the car?
No, but the police officers were in the parking lot of a Toys R Us.
Toys R Us makes me want to shoot up, too. I totally understand that.
In Holbrook, preparing to set up surveillance when they saw a woman parked in a car tie a strap around her left arm at 1:20 p.m. yesterday.
Good old afternoon put me down.
Yeah. Now, I'm wondering why the officers were setting up surveillance. I mean, did somebody call in?
Wait, did it say it was surveillance or they just happened to be there?
Yeah, they preparing to set up surveillance. I don't know what they were surveilling.
Maybe there's some corrupt money laundering going on at KFC. Or KFC, Toys R Us.
They're very similar. They're very similar.
The giraffe just makes me think of chicken.
As the police officers approached the vehicle, they say they saw 29-year-old Crystal Weberly prepare to inject herself with heroin while her 2-month-old son sat in the back seat.
Was she gonna like give him a little drop to ease his times?
You put it on your finger,
yeah,
and rub it on the gums.
Yeah,
the
gums. A little baby gummer. They really did rub heroin on babies' gums back in the day for like numbing purposes and cocaine.
Wow, well that is scary. As the officers,
cocaine was medicine. Sorry.
Well, that's true. That is true.
And heroin started out as a medication. Well, not. I mean, it was popularized, but.
The officers were able to stop Weberly from injecting the heroin and recovered the needle. Weberly was charged with endangering the welfare of a child, criminal possession of a controlled substance, seventh degree, criminal possession of a hypodermic instrument, and driving a Nissan Sentra.
Oh, so in New York you can get criminal possession of a hypodermic needle, eh?
Right, if you're not. That's, you know what, in a lot of places now, hypodermic needles are prescription only.
Oh, yeah.
Like you have to have a note from a doctor that says,
thank God for needle exchanges, right? Yeah. Am I right?
In fact, Fred Meyer will not sell you, if you're a diabetic. Fred Meyer will not sell you lancets to, you know, the thing that pops into your skin to make you bleed to check your blood sugar. They will not sell you lancets unless you have a prescription, which is, I think that might be a Kroger thing.
What if you just want to poke yourself?
What if you just everyday
like
poking?
I just like to stab myself to remind me I'm alive.
That's called cutting. That's a whole different thing. That's not diabetes.
Cutting leaves scars. A little lancet, though. You can just little reminder.
The pain doesn't last long, though, with the lancet. I'm telling you.
That's why you need a prescription so you can get lots of them.
Oh, there was a passenger in Weberly's vehicle, 26-year-old Jacqueline DeTilo. She was charged with loitering, first degree, endangering the welfare of a child, criminal possession of controlled substance in the seventh degree, and criminal possession of a hypodermic instrument. So I think she had her own kit.
Well, any junkie's worth half a damn does.
Has her own kit.
You know, I saw a junkie take a knee the other day, and I was blown away and wondering if he got... Because, like, a few different people have jokes about watching junkies move, and it's like they will move in any way not to ever actually fall over. So they're, like, somehow still staying upright, yet totally collapsed. And I saw a junkie take a knee. Like, it was one of the most fucked up people I've seen in public in a long time. And he just sat down in front of a bus in the bus lane and didn't respond. Like, and the bus was like honking at him. And it's not like he was ignoring it. He just didn't know it was there.
He didn't even put an arm up to say, give me a minute. Just
no. And then like a TriMet cop came over and they're like, can't handle your booze, can you? He's like, I don't drink. Junkies, a talking junkie took a knee. It was all kinds of miracles.
Good Lord. A notification, thankfully, was put into Child Protective Services, and the child was released into the custody of his grandmother, who only does meth. So there,
she only has prescription brand opiates, so everything's okay. I hope that lady wasn't breastfeeding because that kid's gonna DT.
Surrounded by Fiends says the junkies I knew would go to Petco and get needles with no questions. You can get needles at Petco for your animals.
Animals need injections too.
Okay. All right. I didn't
tip to the junkies out there if you need some needles. Just, I wonder if they're different. How they're different.
I wonder if they're like, well, I wonder if they're customized with like kittens and puppies on them.
Oh,
that would be nice.
Precious little paw prints on the needle.
That'd be nice. The plunger looks like a little kitten paw coming out of it or something. I don't know. That's actually kind of weird.
Kittens would help make you not want to do heroin so bad. So you're like, oh, kittens are cute. The world is okay.
But be careful. Do not shoot your kitten up with heroin. That
is
bad.
Unless you want to see something pretty hilarious. My cat's on heroin right now.
Both of the people in the car were held overnight, and they will be arraigned today. in a central islip.
Did they say whether they had been in the Toys R Us or not yet?
They do not. I'm hoping.
Is it a pre or post pick me up?
I'm thinking it was a pre.
Because I can understand.
I think it was pre.
I couldn't imagine getting high on heroin and going shopping. Like, it seems like it would be pointless. Or do they just like to shoot up in a Toys R Us parking lot?
That is a good question. Although it may be a good place to buy it. That might be the place to go.
Inconspicuous. Yeah. Who's going to look in front of a toy store?
Right, just pull up next to a van.
Same way whenever you want to steal from a Barnes & Noble's, you go to the Christian section and put it in your bag.
But who wants to read that shit?
No, you take a book with you to the Christian section.
Oh, because
and
no one's
no one's there and no one's looking.
No cameras trained
Barnes
on the Christian.
Barnes & Noble's don't really, the only thing that they have tabs on are their CDs. Is Barnes & Noble still open?
Yeah.
It was Borders that just shut down.
Borders is closed, yeah.
But, yeah, so you just, it's really easy to steal from that place. You just go to the Christian section and put it in your bag.
Well, then it stands to reason that would also be, if you're wanting to masturbate in a Barnes & Noble, that would be the good section to go to masturbate
in. Those big cushy chairs right out, but they're everywhere. You just sit down, have a wink.
You can lay face down on
the... I hope that everyone realizes that every episode I'm going to give you a trick is to steal from a different company. I, however, don't steal anymore, so you guys, I'm living vicariously through you. Let me know how your thievery goes. Sandwiches and books, we've gotten those covered in the last few shows. I've talked about other places, too.
Yeah. So, shoplifting tips from Jesse. That's a new segment. Shoplifting tips with Jesse. We need some flowery music. Maybe the Toys R Us theme in the background.
Yeah.
It's good to be a kid.
Toys R Us, where a fiend can be a fiend.
There you go. Let me take you now to lovely, lovely San Diego, California.
San Diego.
San Diego.
San Diego.
There you go. Now there you got it.
I like San Diego for some things.
What do they have? The Gaslight District or whatever? That's a nice, where all the bars are down there.
I like North Park. It's a little slummier, but it's where the cool kids hang out in my book.
The U.S. Navy has a very large presence in San Diego.
Oh, yeah, they do.
Lots of seamen there.
Yeah, we went down there for Labor Day weekend, and our hotel was full of people that were off base for the weekend. So it was really weird because there was like a punk music festival going on and then a bunch of Navy people.
Anyway, the U.S. Navy said yesterday it was discharging 64 seamen.
That's a lot of seamen.
49 of them from the aircraft carrier that buried Osama bin Laden at sea for using or distributing drugs.
Oh, the same men who buried Osama
are drugs.
Drug addicts. Mm. I learned some tricks about shooting heroin discreetly from my father due to his time in the Navy.
Seriously?
You shoot it up between your toes.
Well,
of
course.
Can't see.
Of course. Of course.
But my dad liked to throw in. I learned that when I was in the Navy. You know, we were all on drugs. You just got to be secret about it.
The one thing my grandfather told me about being in the Navy was that all the rope was made of hemp and that they would smoke the rope.
Well, and that's dumb because that stuff is like cured and it would be like smoking a broom. Like you could smoke straw out of a broom and eventually get high because of lack of oxygen to your brain.
And it wasn't because they were pot smokers. It was because they were out at sea for so long that everybody ran out of cigarettes.
Oh, so they just needed something to smoke.
They needed something to smoke. So.
Other than each other's poles.
Exactly.
Oh.
All of the sailors are from three San Diego-based commands. Most of the sailors assigned to the aircraft carrier USS Carl Vinson, a nuclear submarine USS San Francisco, and a floating fueling dock were caught
using... USS Vinson Price.
I was going to go with the USS Oprah, a
floating fueling dock.
Where they were caught.
FFD.
They were caught using, possessing, or selling the designer drug Spice. The Navy has said.
What is the world coming to when even our armed forces are doing weird mock drugs?
Yeah, really.
I've been to San Diego. You can get weed anywhere there.
Yeah, it's close to Mexico. I mean, you
can
get anything.
How regularly do they really drug test you in the service?
In the Navy, unless there's a suspicion, I don't think they really do that. I don't think that they really are into that. Well, Bin Laden was buried at sea from the Carl Vinson in May.
Oh, we got so ripped, and then we threw the motherfucker in the ocean. It was crazy. Like, he was like bobbing and shit. It was awesome.
I just like the fact that I have this vision that a bunch of dudes just like throwing him overboard. You know, the mummy. He looks like a mummy. They throw him overboard. And they go back to smoking their fake marijuana that they bought at a bodega in South San Diego.
Imagine them giggling, like, look at him.
It's floating.
Oh, man. Being a sailor would be so fun.
Most of the sailors assigned to the... The ship normally has 5,000 sailors on board during deployment, and a spokesman for the Third Fleet said it was unknown if any of the sailors were facing discipline were involved in the Bin Laden operation directly. But their boat was. The Navy's policy on drug abuse is simple and clear. Zero tolerance, said Vice Admiral General Gerald Beeman, commander of the Third Fleet. Drug use puts lives and missions at risk and undercuts the unit readiness and morale. Well, I don't know. It makes morale pretty good.
Weed does not bring down morale. Heroin, maybe. Cocaine, on occasion. Weed, no.
Spice is a synthetic drug known as fake pot that mimics the effects of marijuana. Hicks said the investigation on the Carl Vinson began when three sailors who were already on restriction for reasons that have not been disclosed were caught smoking spice in a fan room.
I just think, for heaven's sake, these are adults, right? Well, I guess maybe not. Like, they're in their early 20s. Well, technically adults, but not like grown-ass people. But it's just ridiculous to me that anyone over the age of, like, 15 is doing this shit.
Yeah.
There was a big thing, because we talked about bath salts recently. There was a big thing on NPR about the bath salt epidemic, and this guy came on, and he was, like, a middle-aged dude, and he was talking about his addiction to bath salts. And I was like, grow up. Just fucking grow up and do real drugs to be addicted to. Like, you're so... It's like that girl... with the dust off from fucking Intervention.
Oh, yeah, I remember
like,
that
fuck
one.
You. Like, yeah. This is a cry for help. You're not addicted to shit. You just need attention and something real to be addicted to.
Intervention. I miss, you know, that's one thing I miss about cables, like Intervention. Is that show still on? Do they still do new Interventions?
I don't know. They have My Strange Addiction now, and they have other shows in that vein.
It's really morphed into more specific.
Oh, yeah. One of my favorite times ever was running into the bald Intervention guy at the airport. It was awesome. I was, like, in a bad mood, and I was not. I was traveling home for less than ideal reasons.
The guy with the mustache?
Mustachioed man. And I saw him in the airport, and he was going to Idaho, too. And I was like, first of all, I know who you are. Second of all, who are you going to deal with? Because I probably know them.
It's not me, is it? Are you coming to intervene me?
Oh. Get real addictions, Navy people.
Andrew, of course, with the Dune reference, the spice must flow. Clabberass says the ingredients of spice show that it does contain THC. So is that not Mary Jane?
I didn't know. If it has THC in it, then how are you supposed to pass drug tests anyways if it's got it in there?
Yeah. Surrounded by Fiends says things named spice are normally horrible. Spice One, Spice Girls, and Spice the Shake Room.
But don't forget about Old Spice, classic man smell.
Oh, Old Spice, never really liked that stench.
When put on in appropriate amounts, I enjoy an Old Spice.
All 64 of the sailors will be administratively discharged. Whether or not it is characterized as a result of criminal behavior, it will be other than an honorable discharge. So a lot of guys out of work, a lot of seamen out of work down there in San Diego. Wonder what they're going to do. Just a lot of seamen.
Hooking for spice. There is a flourishing prostitution market in San Diego.
Oh, God.
They could probably use some pretty Navy men.
Not all Navy men are pretty, though.
I want to imagine that these ones are.
You need me on that. You want me on that wall. You need me on that wall, smoking my spice.
Yeah, damn right. they're just so close to Mexico. They could do so much better. I'm disappointed in the U.S. Navy right now.
It is baffling. And appropriately, here's the dope show out as we go to our break. We'll be right back soon, so don't go nowhere.
Right back soon.
Right back soon.
Bye. We are all stars.
Hey, it's Court.
And it's Fat Boy.
If you're looking for, you know, general nerdery.
If you want to know what Portland would think if Portland had a mouth and could speak, come listen to Court and Fat Boy.
We're Portland's mouth.
We are Portland's filthy, goofy, nerdy mouth.
Come give us a kiss.
Court and Fat Boy, 10 a.m., Cascadia.fm.
Mobster meatballs, meatballs so good they'll get you off.
Hi, I'm Tyler Ryan, CEO and co-founder of Mobster Meatballs Food Cart and Catering. And whether it's pork, turkey, buffalo, yak, or veggie, I want you to taste my balls with delicious sauces like Indian masala, marinara, spicy peanut, and country gravy. We're located on College Street between 4th and 5th Avenue in downtown Portland and online at www.mobstermeatballs.com. We've got meatballs so good, they'll get you offed.
Mobster meatballs, meatballs so good, they'll get you offed.
It's so stupid.
You're listening to Cascadia.fm, you lucky some bitches.
The Dandy Warhols. That was actually that the video for that song was filmed at Dante's.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, and I think I'm not certain, but I think that the I want to say the Dandies are playing a show at Dante's in December.
Yeah, I believe I heard some. Maybe yeah. Actually, you were talking.
Maybe I said
about
that.
It.
Maybe I said that already, but. I would like to go to that show, and hopefully they haven't played. It's hard for them to play Godless live because they normally don't have a trumpet player.
I know how to play the trumpet.
Do you?
Mm-hmm.
Well, there you go.
Secondary effect of learning how to play the French horn.
You should learn. You know what? You should learn the trumpet part from Godless,
and then stand in the audience and
just
play
stand,
it.
Stand in the audience play because when they do try to play it live, like one of the I think it's the drummer goes. Like he mimics the trumpet with his mouth. He does a good job, but it's still not a trumpet. Still not
I'm
a
gonna
trumpet.
Have to get my hands on a trumpet. Actually, I know an owner of a trumpet.
There you go. Just open that spit valve first.
Oh yeah.
You never know what's in there. You never know what's hiding in the spit compartment of a trumpet.
Nothing good.
I don't think that when you were younger you were here it comes. Let the sneeze fly.
It's not coming, though. It keeps teasing, but not actually coming. So
don't talk to me like Nick. Anyway, did you have Barbies when you were a kid?
I did. I was always forced to play Ken. It was the classic. Classic Sarah always got to be Barbie, and I always had to be Ken. And then she would go too far, and I would feel awkward.
Anyway, well, there's a new Barbie out called Toki Doki Barbie.
Toki Doki.
Toki Doki.
Token and Doken.
It's not your mother's Barbie, as the article tells us.
Oh, God, I'm so glad that everything's not my mother's anymore.
Yeah. She has hardcore tattoos on her upper chest and neck.
I'm air quoting right now.
Yeah. She is the result of a partnership between Mattel and a Los Angeles-based...
What kind of drug addiction does she come with?
I don't know. Spice. But she's a partnership between Mattel and a Los Angeles-based fashion brand called Toki Doki, which means sometimes in Japanese.
Toki Doki.
Toki Doki. Mattel said there's no controversy.
What, Harajuku Lovers wasn't down for it? When Stefani didn't have time for Barbie line?
I think there was maybe I'm just thinking of Sailor Moon dolls, but I thought there was a Sailor Moon Barbie, but I think it was just a Sailor Moon doll.
Yeah, Mattel might have put one out. Yeah.
Barbie has, this is Mattel's statement, Barbie has sported an endless array of styles. Many of Barbie's most popular pop culture couture outfits have been designed for the adult doll collector. The Toki Doki Barbie is a perfect example of a limited edition doll sold through select retail locations. Yeah.
If you really like bad couture fashion, you should buy this.
There are a lot of moms on blogs and on social media complaining, but there are also moms that out there that look and dress like this. There are moms that have...
Hold the phone. Mothers are complaining on social media websites?
Believe it or not, it's happening.
Goodness me.
This might be a trend.
About a Barbie?
Yeah, this might be. We might see...
Because they haven't been bitching about Barbie since, like, the
80s. Yeah. Well... mommy bloggers are all up in arms, I guess, about this.
Mothers.
But the fact is, I mean, there are moms out there that have pink hair and tattoos like this Barbie, so.
Yeah, real whatever. People. Does she smoke? I want her to have a pack of cigarettes.
I don't know. As long as they're, like, Jarums. A pack of Jarums sticking out of her, jorts.
I'm just gonna smoke some beedies, you know. I don't smoke real cigarettes.
Still
cool.
I think this is an idea whose time has come. I can't think of any other actual kids' toys that you know glorify that pop culture correctly.
There was a Barbie that you could draw your own tattoos on her. Like she came like with the special marker that was like permanent but not permanent, and also like removable tattoos for you and your Barbie. So the Barbie, you could tattoo your Barbie and give yourself a removable tattoo as well.
Well, let's face facts. That tattoo yourself Barbie or whatever it was called was not really for the little girls. That was for their younger brothers to draw penises on Barbie.
Well, yeah.
That's what the
and
that's
be
what
permanent,
it was for. And not be permanent.
Be awesome. I always thought that it was a good idea to draw on my Barbies, and then it never was. I had great plans for what their makeup would look like, and then it didn't.
I remember my sister had a lot of Barbies, but I never tortured them or really did anything to them. I think I might have ripped one head off.
Cut a lot of Barbie hair.
Yeah.
I would also just get angry at them and break them.
Well, they had everything. She had a nice car, a beautiful house, great boyfriend. He didn't have a penis.
She didn't work for any of it.
Well, her boyfriend, Ken, had no penis, so she wasn't bugged with that thing.
There are certain people, when I see them, I go, you have a Ken doll crotch. Looking at you right now, there's no way I can believe you have an actual penis.
Very smooth
there's
down there.
It's like a weird front flap contour.
You know, there are certain types of pants that gentlemen out there wear that just give them a real smooth, glass-like surface.
Well, this is almost more like personality-wise and just looking at them and their exterior. I go, there's nothing under your pants.
Now, this brings up a good question. As a female, heterosexual mostly, do you
prefer... I don't have a sex.
I don't have
or a sexual precedence. Precedence. I can't talk. Preference.
I'm going to be your sexual president. Do you like to see a bundle down there on a man, or would you prefer? Or is it not something
it's
you're looking
friggin
for?
Friggin' ridiculous. No, bulges are so dumb. Like it's so dumb. It's like if you don't have one, I feel kind of bad for you. But dudes who like purposely bulge it up, it's like, come on, buds. There's this dude who's the lead man of a local band.
Uh-huh.
He always wears the tightest pants and does a lot of like pelvic thrusting.
But there's nothing new about that. That's been going on for
decades. He has no bulge whatsoever, so I just feel bad for him because I'm like...
Thomas Lauderdale?
No, not Thomas Lauderdale. Close. Good guess. But it's always so sad to me because I'm like, all that thrusting and all those tight pants and nothing to show for it.
I thought you were going to say that, you know, you could just see everything and then you went the other way with, it just looks like a Ken doll up there on stage. Well,
so
from the lap down.
I mean, there should be something there. Not a bulge. I don't, it's not like I look for a package first. I'm more of an ass lady. I prefer a bubble to a bulge.
Is that a cat lady? Instead of cats, you have jackasses roaming around your house.
I love butts. Right. I get caught staring at people's butts. And sometimes it's a lady's butt, and it's like, damn, I wish I had that butt. And sometimes it's a dude's butt, and I'm like, yeah, I wish I had that butt. I was jealous of a man's ass a couple weekends ago, and I felt weird inside because I was like, I wish I had that guy's butt. Like, I'm jealous of it.
Now, do you mean you have it as your own butt or like around your face?
I wanted it on my body. Like, he had a perfect ass, and I wish I had
but
an ass.
But that still doesn't clarify. You mean?
I wish I had an ass like his.
Okay, okay.
My ass looked like his.
I just had to clarify there. I didn't know.
It was a weird moment. He had a nice ass. I bet he could clap his cheeks together. Oh, those don't qualify as asses.
Is that from Asses of Portland? That's from the Asses. Is that, that's not you, is it, Robert? Is it? Okay. Somebody tweeted me the Asses of Portland or something. There's an Asses of Portland website.
And it's just pictures of people's asses?
Yeah, and it's like people of Walmart, but it's like the Asses of Portland. And somebody tweeted at me, and it's the guy, and he's like, this would be perfect for your show. I'm like, how the hell? I mean, what if...
Visual gags work so great on radio and podcasting.
No, I mean, it's not like thepotshot.com where you could actually follow along. But I mean, I'm really gonna do a segment where I describe pictures of asses on my show for half an hour every Thursday. I'm sorry, it's just not going to work.
I know what I'm checking out when I get home.
Pone Tony says that's got to be a huge website. It is a lot of bandwidth, sir. A lot of bandwidth.
Waste bandwidth.
Okay. Here's the story that I didn't want to tell you about.
The secret story.
This is just horrific. A $2,500 reward is being offered for an arrest and conviction in a terrible case of animal abuse. According to Gina Knepp with the City of Sacramento Animal Care Services, the owners of a small terrier mix contacted the shelter last month saying their dog was badly hurt. Someone had attached the end of a leash to the dog's genitals.
Mean.
Veterinarians at the shelter operated on the dog named Wheezy.
Oh, Wheezy's weenie got fucked with.
And now the shelter is hoping for some tips.
For the dog ball ruiner? That is so weird. Like, who does that? What if they were mad at Wheezy and they did it themselves? And how does the woman who portrayed Wheezy Jefferson feel about that name? Was Wheezy ever actually on the show, or did he always just say, one day, Wheezy, I'm coming to you?
You're confusing shows with black people on them. You're confusing Sanford and Son and the Jeffersons.
Oh, yeah, you're right. It's not just a racist thing. It's also a timeline thing. Like, I'm just like, they're old TV shows. I don't know. I don't know the difference between shows.
They're beyond your scope.
But I remember Wheezy, and now I've figured it out. Yes, you're right, because the one was with Red Fox, and he would talk to his dead wife, and the other one, Wheezy, was actually alive.
Pone Tony says, black shows, they look all the same to me. I don't know.
It's just as much old shows are all the same to me, but then you throw the race in there, and I'm really confused.
This story really hit home for me because I do like to participate in genital torture every once in a while. I like to
animal genital mutilation.
No, my own genitals. I don't.
You have your girlfriend wrap a leash around them?
No, I do it in the privacy of my own hell.
It's a private thing.
It's what I do at the Christian book section at Borders.
Barnes & Noble.
Borders, actually, you can steal anything you want from Borders now.
Probably.
There's nobody there. You can take anything you want.
Wouldn't even notice.
I broke into the Borders the other day and I found a cardboard box of, and I didn't know how this, I don't know how this happened, but they already had a bunch of Duff McKagan's autobiography that they were throwing out. And they haven't been open for months, so I don't know who that is. Duff McKagan, he was a guy from Guns N' Roses, and he had a book come out this week.
Oh, Duff. Yeah. I didn't know his last name.
He's on the Twitter if you'd like
I'm
to.
I'm so excited if you'd like to follow Duff McKagan, he's on Twitter. So I can listen to Cold November Rain over and over. I heard it 2 days ago, and I shut my ears off and went, no, I'm saving this song for November.
It is appropriate because we are approaching November.
And it's going to be cold and rainy.
Are you gearing up for Halloween? Or are you a big Halloween person?
I like Halloween, but I can't decide on who I'm going to be.
That's actually more of a life problem.
Sadly, I have no choice but to be who I am in life. So the things where I have choices, it's hard.
And you are a comedian. Where will you be being yourself on stage the next few days? I don't know if that makes sense or not.
I don't know what's going on this weekend, but Tuesday, everyone, Tuesday.
What day?
Tuesday.
There you go.
8:30 p.m. doors. Come to the Eagles Lodge. It is my friend Taylor and I's first show there. It's called Where Eagles Dare. It's a $5 cover. We'll be co-hosting, and we will be chatting with and also hearing jokes from the wonderful Whitney Strieg, Christian Ricketts, Tynan DeLong.
Oh, and my Jeffrey Oliver. Oh, my goodness.
It's going to be a penis-packed evening of hilarity. And Taylor and I will bring the breasts.
Now, the one thing I have to ask you is, what time does it start?
Doors are at 8:30.
Okay. I will probably arrive a little late, as I have tickets to a screening of The Rum Diary. And I really want to see that really stoned.
I heard awful things
about
it.
Oh, really? Bad things?
I heard it was awful.
Oh.
It wasn't exactly his best book. I mean, like, I love Hunter S. Thompson, and I enjoyed The Rum Diaries to some extent. But I've heard it's not a very good movie.
Huh. Well, then.
Sorry to be shit on your Sunday.
That sucks.
But, yeah, I'm prone to believe hatred because it's easier than to actually figure things out for yourself.
Well, you heard it here first. Jesse hates pop culture.
That's not true. I love it.
All right. Well, so the Eagles Lodge next Tuesday. Go there, be there, and have fun. I will probably show up at some point. And Jesse, thank you so much for coming in today. And we're back to our normal schedule next week. No more absences. I really do not want to miss any more shows that are planned with you, because you're just such a special, special woman.
Thanks.
But as for now, this is Unibash Radio, where the news of the day
goes to die.